here on four the many faces and voices of the little blonde number from Down Under, the Paul Hogan Show.
Spanner, scientist, physicist, licensed plumber. Searching for a way to tap into human strength. Then an accidental overdose of Alka-Seltzer alters his body chemistry. Now, when David Spanner grows angry, a startling metamorphosis occurs. And he becomes the incredible Weed. Displaying his brute strength. Yes, there was only one word for him. Strong. what's the secret of this incredible green weed?
Green dishwashing liquid. You're soaking in it.
And so David Spanner, believed dead, must let the world think he's dead until he can control the raging spirit that dwells within him.
Make me angry. Like when I'm angry.
What is the answer to his dilemma? How can he release his tormented soul? A further dose of radiation? More gamma rays? What is the answer to his terrible problem?
Good evening. Hope you had a nice day. Let's have a look at our chart and see how things went. Quite a mixed bag, as you can see today. Caused mostly by this coal front up here in the Gulf, moving down through the Kimberleys, across the Great Divide, and over to the coast. Also affecting our chart was this thigh pressure, just below Tasmania, which is should move north tomorrow and settle somewhere about here over surface parallax. Oh, the temperature today was pretty widespread, topped with a maximum of 37 up here at Mount Pleasant. And going all the way down to a low of 14 down here at Perisher Valley. Oh, incidentally, there was a little drizzle reported earlier up here, just below the bite. That's expected to clear up soon. All right, so much for today's lovely weather. Let's have a look now and see what tomorrow has in store for us. Doesn't look very promising, does it? All in all, a pretty daggy day tomorrow. Have you all.
My dear pupils, as the rubbing together of two or more surfaces so as to produce heat. If you were to ask me, Professor, why is this so, I would answer you thus. Shut up. I don't know, and if I did, I wouldn't tell you. Therefore, applying the principles of friction to cookery, it is obvious that we only need to drag this steak, see, behind the family sedan for a distance of 4.5 kilometers at approximately 180 kilometers per hour to achieve the same amount of cooking energy as 5 minutes under the average griller. Is that not amazing? Behold, before applying the formula, after. Astounding. You listening to this, stupid? To go with it, let's try for some crispy French fries. For every chip, you'll need approximately 8 sheets of sandpaper. Let me warn you, good people, if you do not observe and save your conserve your fuel, your only alternative method of transport could be this.
The tension mounts at the East-West talks.
Answer the question, comrade, if you please. What was Julius Marx more commonly known as?
Karl?
No, Groucho.
Well, here's one for your arms expert. What's tattooed on Popeye's arm?
Gentlemen, enough. The Star Wars question. Who was Luke Skywalker's father?
Trivial pursuit. 6,000 questions of no vital importance whatsoever. Hot Point made the fridge that kept the food fresh, that went into the oven, that made the meal, that spilt down the shirt, that was washed in the machine, that was next to the cleaner, that was in the kitchen, that had all the appliances, that have a free 5-year parts guarantee, that it's no wonder so many people say, thank you, Hot Point.
Ryan Ferry, Boys and Girls. On album or cassette, $4.99. Compact disc, $9.99. At HMV, the world's best music stores.
If just one family played Mobile's new game and won a prize every day, a holiday tomorrow, a top cash prize the next day, a car after that, by the time Mobile ran out of prizes, they'd be almost 3,000 years old. A million prizes will make a lot of happy families. And if they'd been collecting the free glasses, they'd have moved to a bigger place.
Are you bored with ordinary cars? At the Alternative and Kit Car Show, you'll see how to make your standard model into a gleaming 1930s roadster, a family tourer, a replica Jaguar, or an off-road Jeep. And that's only the start. With over 100 manufacturers making 200 models, there's something for everyone. At the third Alternative and Kit Car Show, Newark.
Good evening and welcome to the second semi-final in our current series of Thickhead, the quiz which endeavours to find the biggest dill in Australia. Could we have our first contestant, please? Could we have our first contestant, please?
In the bloody chair.
Your name, please.
Name.
Pass.
Your occupation?
Private detective.
And your special subject?
Kings of England, 1531 to 1532.
Your questions begin now. Henry VIII's first wife, Catherine of Aragon's third cousin, Simon, who married the fifth daughter of the Duke of Marlborough, Edward de Rothman, had an uncle, Hector, the Earl of Crawford, whose sister Mary was later burnt at the stake by Angus of Norway. During this time in the Tower prior to being beheaded, how tall was he? Well, your time is up. And at the end of your first round, you have failed to score. Oh, you did pass on one question, your name, the answer to which was Frank Johnson. Could we have our next thickhead, please? Yeah. Your name, please?
Raquel Fogg.
And your occupation, Raquel?
Beauty consultant.
And your special subject?
The works of William Shakespeare.
And at the end of your round, you've got three. Congratulations, dear. Well, the excitement really building here as we bring on our final thickhead. Name, please?
Red Sharpie, ferret breeder.
And your special subject?
General knowledge.
Very good. Your questions begin now. What did Elizabeth Taylor say on her wedding night?
Can I have that again, please?
Correct. Complete the following comedy team, Laurel Ann.
Ooh, that's a hardy.
Correct. What's the first note on the musical scale?
Eight.
Correct. Describe the mating call of the Tibetan Lama.
Huh?
Correct. The cry of the Lithuanian hoot owl.
Who?
Correct again. And finally, complete the well-known quote of the dynamic Jack Lord in the popular Hawaii Five-O series when he turns to his assistant and says, book him.
Dunno.
Book him, Dunno is correct. And at the end of your round, you have answered all your questions correctly, which means you're a smart aleck and have got no place on this show. Get rid of him. And our winner tonight, who failed to score, Frank Johnson. Frank, will you come back next week and appear in our thickhead final?
Pass.
That's it. Good night from thickhead. This was me Saturday night gear in the 50s. You see, I just went to see that John Travolta movie, Saturday Night Fever. And I was struck by the fact that nothing's really changed much. I mean, now they go to the discos and they dance to the Bee Gees. In the 50s, we used to go to rock and roll dance at the beer garden and dance to Little Richard. Better songs then. No, deep, meaningful lyrics in the 50s, you hear that? Malop, bobaloo, bop. Malop, bam, boom. Tutti, frutti, ah, Rudy. And you can lay awake all night just thinking about that, couldn't you? And in the discos now, they're all trying to look like John Travolta, right? In the 50s, it was Elvis. I mean, I tried so hard to get that Elvis sneer on my mouth that for 3 nights I went to bed with a clothes peg on my lip. And then Marlon Brando came on the scene. So I bought a bike, leather jacket, sunglasses, in the middle of the night, mind you. 27 sticks of chewy in the gob. And I'd sit on the bike and pose outside the dance. Hey, I'm come for burn. I never got any takers. I don't know if it was because they couldn't understand me with all the chewy me gob, or whether they just didn't like push bikes. Anyhow, I soon realised that if you really wanted to win a heart, you had to go inside to the dance. So I sent away for the Arthur Murray Correspondence Course of Dancing. Well, I could get the girls up all right, but as soon as I'd start chalking the footprints on the floor, I'd walk away. Anyhow, every Saturday night, I'd have a bath, whether I needed or not. Put on this sharp gear, half a bottle of California Poppy on my head, half a tube of Clearasil on my face, and I'd go strutting out the door, thinking I looked like $1 million. And strutting was the word, because all us lairs in the 50s used to walk the same way.
Elbows out. And wobble your head a lot as you walk. You can always tell when there's a Lear walking behind you. Because first of all, you can smell his B.O. And secondly, you can hear his brain rattle.
Anyway,
and as you went out the door, my mum, and all mums were the same, they'd always cut you down to size. You'd be strutting out the door $1 million, and they'd sing out,
I hope you're wearing clean underpants. You might get run over by a truck.
What sort of logic is that? I mean, if you get run over by a truck, your underpants are going to change colour anyway. And what do mum think goes on at the hospital? The doctor comes along and says, oh, this poor kid's got a broken leg. I'll fix that. Hold it. He's got dirty underpants on. Keep out of your eye, touch him. But maybe they think it's going to be in the paper. Kid wearing dirty underpants. The thing was, to get onto Birds then, you had to have a car. Well, me and most of my mates were only about 15. Too young to drive. So we knocked around with an older bloke, a 17-year-old named Wart. Now, Wart was a real dag. But did he have the car to get onto the women? A Morris Minor convertible. Leopard skin upholstery, GT stripe, and two surfboards permanently welded to the roof. And he'd always have an army blanket in the back and half a dozen bottles of beer in case he got onto a Sheila. And two big paper bags in the glove box. One to put over her head and one to put over his in case her slipped off. So we'd all up in the car with Wart, five abreast across the front seat, and we'd go cruising. The problem was that in the 50s, we were pretty naive at that age at 15 about girls, see? Because we never had sex education at school. And the nearest we got to it was a hygiene lesson once a month off the local priest. And that usually went no further than, keep your body clean. If you have impure thoughts, take a long, cold shower. Well, that didn't work. I was the soggiest kid in high school. And it was the pre-permissive era. See, they didn't even have pictures of topless girls in the paper. About the only place you could get a good look at them was in the New Guinea section of the National Geographic. I spent so much time studying the National Geographic, my mum and dad thought I wanted to be an archaeologist. Anyway, because of this lack of information, at 15, we were sort of almost scared of girls, you know? But we never let on. I mean, I remember cruising down the street and I'd stick my head out the door very suavely. I said to a girl, g'day, how about a bit? Well, she looked me straight in the eye and said, a bit of what? Well, I don't know. It was embarrassing, we had to drive off, you know. Once we were cruising down there, we saw a couple of older women, 18-year-olds. So we pulled up alongside them and said, g'day, want to come for a ride? And they said, yeah, and hopped in the back. We all panicked and hopped straight out. So with that sort of expertise, it's not surprising that Saturday nights for us, me in particular, usually ended up with three cheeseburgers washed down with more warm bottle beer than your stomach could handle, which usually led to a 15-minute ride in a spinning bed and ended with a technicolor yawn out the bedroom window. And that disease then was known as Saturday night fever.
Put you in the right frame of mind with which to end Saturday night. If you want something to smile at tomorrow night, the Irish RM at 8:15 should provide just that. When John Wells casts aside his much-acclaimed portrayal of Dennis Thatcher to play a far less lovable, nay, pompous friend of the Yates family. But for now, from us here, and me, Veronica Hicks, smiling broadly, may we wish you all a very good night.